Help us, there is planning behind it, right? And no matter how much human beings may attribute their, or they may, impose their beliefs and their views on the creation of the heavens and the earth, it's of no consequence to what the truth is. No matter how much human beings, through their own empirical reasoning and through their empirical sciences and all these sciences, may come up to certain theories about the creation of the universe, it doesn't detract from the fact that their idea of this being a consequence of the Big Bang, or for that matter, as a result of evolution, or man being a result of what we would call a natural selection, is the truth. It's a false theory. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, but خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ فَإِذَا هُوَ خَصِيمُ بِهِ. He should disputations openly. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throws the gauntlet down humanity's throat. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, hey mankind, do me a favor, you know, my words, shut up, will you? Shut up. This idea of yours about your knowledge being divine and supreme and without reproach and free from any error is the biggest shirk that you have committed, because you have attributed divine knowledge and you know, all-encompassing knowledge to yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala draws attention to man to say, hold on, you're a product of natural selection, right? Simple. You're a product of the, what we call Darwinian evolution. Tell me, why isn't there the gap being bridged between the apes and human beings yet? When man was created, right, apes had preceded man, right? But there hasn't been the leap between the apes and human beings upon which the Darwinian theory is based, that man originated from the apes. Why hasn't the gap been bridged in so many millennia? Why not? Has there been any evolution of any other species beyond the human species on planet Earth? Isn't that the theory of natural selection, survival of the fittest? Human beings have destroyed the Earth, right, in various stages. Either they didn't have a direct road in it, through the Bronze Age and the Ice Age and the this age and that age and whatever it is. But in terms of modernity and whatever it is, we've had situations in World War I, World War II, through world wars and whatever it is that we've had, and through diseases, you know, influenza disease, where massive amounts of the human population has been decimated. Why is there no new other creation? Why has this theory of natural selection stopped at the human species? There should have been a hybrid now. You know, after so many human beings procreating and billions of human beings on planet Earth, there should have been some type of gene differentiation when a new species came out. Do you understand my argument? This is the theory of evolution, that natural selection. So in the survival of the fittest, if God realized that, you know what, I'm being very racist here, right? And I'm using a racist perspective, not my own personal one. I'm giving you the white supremacist perspective. Where indeed the Aryan race, you know the Aryan race? Hitler and them regard themselves the Aryan race, not the Indian Aryans, not the Aryan race, regard themselves as the most supreme, right? And through the process of natural selection, they had the blonde eyes and the blonde hair and the blue eyes and the white skin, right? Why hasn't evolution and the theory of natural selection gotten rid through the process of survival of the first of the black people? Why not? Why hasn't there been evolution in terms of the size of our brains? Why hasn't there been a process, through the process of natural selection, that people, because of the so-called supremacy and because of the exposure to knowledge, education, and all of these tools that we have today, that the brains of the species in the first world should be far more advanced genetically now through the process of survival of the fittest than the brains in third world countries? Have you ever heard of something like that? Do you understand the argument? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ. Oh man, you who's disputing about the nature of the creation of the universe and the purpose and the intent of the creation of the universe, and regard yourself as so supreme and evolved creature, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you've been created from amount of fluid. 15 mils of seminal fluid has plus minus 300 million human potentials in it. Do you know that? Did you know that? 15 mils, that's one tablespoon of male seminal fluid, has 300 plus minus million human potential in it. That's how much a sperm is inside. Meaning, enough for 300 million human beings actualized. But there's only one egg.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, you've been created from that. خَلَأَتَ عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينُ مِنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْءٍ مَذْكُورًا. Now, was there not a time when there was a time upon man when he was not worthy of anything, worthy of mention? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is choosing this. You've been created from a drop of blood. Mankind, with all of your technological advancement, with all your scientific theory, with all your advancements in mapping the human genome, you know, the human genome project, with all of this, synthetically create seminal fluid. Create it, come on. Come on. You're talking about the process of natural selection. It's a random sequence of the genes, right? Create an artificial synthetic form of seminal fluid. Create one potential sperm out of 300 million plus minus in 15 mils of fluid. We can only create one. And then germinate that one that you've created, right? Through what's it? They'll tell you, they break it down on it. No, sperm is made out of amino acids and, you know, this protein here and that one there and blah, 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 blah. And this is what it means. And it's made out of the genes of the human body. So create one artificial one. One out of 300 million in 15 mils of fluid. Come on. Which you can't even see with the naked eye. You have to see it through a microscope. Create one like that. And realize how insignificant your origins truly are. And that too, you can't replicate the origin of one single human being or one single potential of a human being. And you're open to dispute it. All of a sudden, because you grew to your natural potential, right, which is your maximized potential as a human being, as an adult, right, who himself now can become a producing machine. Now this is interesting. You can't do it artificially. No scientist yet in the greatest lab on planet Earth has been able to create an artificial, I don't know what's the word for it, sperm, one single one in any laboratory. Yet billions of males do it naturally. Without any effort. Billions of females produce one egg which can be fertilized naturally in the body. So where's all your account? In a process that you have no control of. You have no control of it. It's just being manufactured in your body. No control over it. Right? You can produce it. But you can't do it knowingly. You can't do it intellectually. You can't do it formally. You can't do it practically. You can't do it. But your body is doing it. Allah is telling you, you've been created from that. And Allah is saying in His sight, as significant as that may be in terms of human potential, Allah says that is insignificant in my sight. It's of no value in my sight. It's not even worthy of mention. Yet it is the potential of the human being which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates. But He said, that's where you started off from. And today, wallah, this is the reality of human life. We're asking our purpose, but you've been created from the dirty seminal fluid. And here you are standing up when you really maximize your potential. You stand up and now you question God. This is the height of shirk. When Allah, ta'ala Allahu amma yushrikun, this is the height of shirk. That an insignificant human being who has one potential amongst 300 million potentials of 15 mil of fluid, when finally reaches his completed, most evolved form, stands up and disputes with God. Did you understand the gravity of the situation? How insignificant we are and how arrogant we are. Sure. Right? Now comes the lifestyle. You know the lifestyle that you and I lead, which the Holy Quran has discussed, right? Now comes the lifestyle which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking you to live. He's telling you that you've been placed as a vicegerent on planet Earth. And everything has been made subservient to you. Meaning this earth has been created and designed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the creatures of this earth have been created and designed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a certain purpose. Our purpose is to worship Allah. Whatever is in the heavens and the earth makes the tasbih of Allah, the tahmid of Allah, and worships Allah. But creation out there and creatures out there have been created specifically for our use. I won't call it a symbiotic relationship because it's more parasitic relationship. They benefit less from us than we do from them. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you an alternative lifestyle. Read the verse now, please. And the cattle.
And He created the cattle. There is one pasture
No, no, no. And he created the cattle. He created them for you. Okay, they didn't translate. Wal an'ama khalaqaha. And he created the cattle and he created them for you. Who benefits most out of cattle? By cattle, I mean cows, goats, sheep, camels. All of this fall under the category of cattle. They are there primarily. They are the domesticated animals for our benefit. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you your purpose in life, that this earth that you and I inhabit, right, there are creatures out there, and there are millions of cattle. Right? When I mean cattle, I mean cows, sheep, pigs, whatever it is, cattle, the camels, and whatever it is. All of them have been created primarily for your use. Cattle are there for the means of production, for production and for provision. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the animal kingdom, those animals that you derive the most amount of benefit from are the cattle, right? You understood the cattle, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ma khalaqaha. Carry on. In them there is warmth.
There is warm costume and they are prophets and of them you eat.
Right. In them there is warmth as well as other use. Lakum fiha dif'un wa manafi'. Right? In it there is warmth for you. Meaning you're using the wool, right, from the sheep and the mohair from the goats, and using the skin from the cattle, and for the matter from camels and other products, leather products and whatever it is there, all of them to provide you with warmth, all of them to provide you with heat and to maintain body temperature. So to protect you from the elements of the. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created for the animals their skin. That's it. You also have skin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this skin is there, but it can be sufficient for you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, use the skins of other animals to benefit yourself. No other species in creation uses any other species and their skins for benefit. Do you know that? We human beings are not the menu, right, for other animals. Right? For lions who are carnivores and you know the beasts of prey, right? You have their food are the hen's bark and this one here and those there. That's the food that they eat. We are not what's the word? We are not food for any other species. Do you know that? Human beings are now. This is where the theory of evolution makes me laugh. When people tell me they believe in theory of evolution, I said, have you thought about this? I said, we are not the food of anybody else. We don't have to fear from animals that we are going to be consumed by them. The only animals that you must fear that will be consumed by human beings. Right? Doggy dog world. You understand? One. Two is that we utilize those animal skins for our benefit. Right? And we maximize it to the greatest potential. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at the industry over here. Just look at the cattle, look at the wool industry, all the benefits that you're getting out of the skin or the wool of sheep. It's mind-boggling. Do you know that? Do you know how many millions, I would say hundreds of millions of sheep are sacrificed annually to cater for the wool industry of the world? Just work out the amount. Just work out the amount. Obviously, none of them die all the time. I mean, they shed maybe twice a year. Just twice a year, I think it is, that these animals are sheared. Do you know that? Or maybe, I'm not too sure, I could be open to correction, right? But it's very few times a year that these animals are sheared. But all of that is sufficient to cater for the entire wool industry. It's amazing, it's mind-boggling. Allah created for us. No other ones. For no other human being. Unless, of course, you have a nice little dog, Fifi, out there, that you know you send to the dog park. You put all those little things for them. But nobody else. Nobody else. And from and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the example of the cattle in particular because you are utilizing every part of their bodies. Every part. The milk that they give for their children, we consume. From there we're making milk, we're making yogurt, we're making cream cheese, we're making, you name it, butter and the works. All of that is coming out from the cattle. The meat is what we consume. And here again you have been told here, in this one and of them you eat. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about a natural lifestyle. Right? Nature and nurture. Now where the problem arises, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you a sign out here that in terms of our sustainability and for self-sustaining, right? In the cattle alone, our basic needs from our clothing, right, to warmth, you know, with our blankets and this and that and whatever it is, to our food, to our drink,
to all the body's nutritional requirements that are needed for a human being to function, you will find it in the animals that you domesticate at home. But we've moved away from that lifestyle. We are no more in contact with the animals that are providing us with all of this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, Allah is in favor. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't endorse the omnivore lifestyle, but He's in favor of it. He said, خَلَقَهَا And you eat from them as well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He doesn't want you to be vegetarian. I created them for you to eat. So don't let anyone come and tell you, you know what, this vegetarian lifestyle is the only lifestyle out there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I created these animals for you to consume. Obviously, it's a different story that you and I, in this modern age, have taken this industry of the cattle in particular, where today there are more cattle than human beings. And the amount of food that is required to feed one cow or one bull or whatever it is, in terms of corn and in terms of grain and in terms of water, in terms of wastage and in terms of carbon emissions, right, is ridiculous. You're aware of that. I think I discussed it more than once, isn't it? Right? It's ridiculous. It's costing us more for this greed that we have for consumption of meat in particular than anything else. And this is what is depleting the earth's resources. Because those big animals that you are trying to feed and that amount of antibiotics and the muck that is going inside, we've taken one of the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the great signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we've abused it to the umpteenth degree, to a point where now the earth itself can't sustain human beings because there's not enough land to sustain those animals which should be of benefit to human beings. Can you see how we mess up the system? We have spoiled the system in terms of vicegerency of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And why is this? It's because of mass production, way beyond our means.
I heard a hadith that said that the Prophet said that the milk from the cow is good for you, but the meat from the cow has a lot of illness.
That's true. Let's not go into the gradient of the hadith, but it's true. Reason being that not that it's not beneficial to you. Excessive consumption of it is not beneficial. Red meat, you ask anybody, excessive amount of red meat is not good for you. Right? Everything in moderation is fine. That's what the Prophet of Allah said. He said there's far more benefits in the milk than in the meat. Because excessive consumption of that and then testosterone, especially in bulls and whatever, where you're getting your steak from, right, also increases, the testosterone is consumed by you. Right? And then the diseases in the blood, particularly, you know, all of that goes into the meat and whatever it is, the disease. And today, in modern technology, with the amount of antibiotics and the hormones that are being pumped into these animals, you will see the amount of, what's it called, estrogen, right? And the amount of testosterone and the balance in those animals is totally off. And this is where the Prophet ﷺ stated, he said excessive use of, that's why the Prophet of Allah actually never consumed so much of meat. To a point when Umar ibn Khattab had a moratorium, he said Muslims only buy meat once a week. That's it. He said it's khamr, meaning the intoxicants of the believers. So Islam permits you, but doesn't encourage you to consume too much of that meat. And particularly in this day and age, when Quran said kulu min tayyibat, eat that which is pure and good. I promise you, I've experienced it, that's why I can tell you, eat the meat, right? From the rural areas in India and Pakistan and in Africa, you know, in all of the, go to Botswana, not so far away, go to Botswana and consume the meat there, taste the flavor of the meat and the benefit of the meat and how easy it is to digest, and eat the junk that you and I are buying from the best quality butchers in Durban, chalk and cheese. And this is the problem. Now again, we're coming back to the nature and the nurture lifestyle, right? We have this overproduction of cattle and whatever it is. If you remember in the 60s and the 50s, many people who lived, even in the Durban area, right, before the imposition of health laws and so on, many people still had sheep and goats in their homes. People still kept chickens in their homes. People, all these class people, you know, from Marisburg and so on, right, most of them had a cow in their yard. Up until the 50s, I remember, I was very small, but up until the 60s, we had free range. Free range chickens, right? Free range goats and sheep running around in the yard. My father used to be like a midwife when the goats used to give birth. I remember him telling me that, you know what, if the animals got hurt and so on, they would actually use wintergreen. Remember wintergreen? They use wintergreen and they would, you know, massage the animal's legs and whatever it is and put a bandage around it and this and that and whatever. And those animals used to give you milk, right? Those chickens used to give you eggs, right? And after a while then you slaughtered those chickens and whatever it is there. And most of people sustain themselves with vegetables. I promise you, you know, there is a trend now amongst the foodies, you know, the natural movement, the organic movement in Durban and Cape Town, where now everyone wants to, instead of the fancy garden that they put up there with the indigenous plants and so on, now people are saying, you know, create your own garden patch and self-sustain and use your rooftops and this and that, blah, 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 blah. When our grannies and great-grandmothers were planting chili trees and they were planting dhania and they were planting this and herbs and everything, and most of your food came from your own garden, we scorned. And we looked at them with scorn. Today, Allah is telling you that this is the nurture, nature, lifestyle that you and I need to get back to. We are not in contact with nature anymore. We're not in contact with the food that we are eating. We don't know where our food is coming from. Nor do we nurture our own food. Meaning, nor do we plant our own food. Nor do we take care of those animals that can provide us with food. Nor do we take responsibility for the food that you and I have. In 2010, when we were doing the construction here, our builder Gulambai, because he's got a farm in Changa. He brought two cuckoos and he came. Now for my son, it was fun, because they would play with the hens, right? Every day, it used to be downstairs, every day, we had about, I think, two or three cuckoos. Every day, we had fresh eggs. Every day, fresh eggs. See the color of that yolk, right? And they were free range, they're coming all over here and picking you up. Of course, my father was sick and tired of them afterward, but they were messing all over the place, right? Right? But every day, you were getting fresh eggs. You were getting fresh eggs. And the amount of barakah in that, you know, if you kept sheep, like, you know, if you make qurbani and sacrifice, I mean, come on, let's be honest about it. 95% of our people who sacrifice the animals in Eid al-Adha, they won't keep that. They won't keep